Hi everyone and welcome back to the Organized Notebook. In this video, we wanted to go over sub-items and dependencies. These two features are very useful in Notion, but could be a bit difficult for beginners to get into, so we just wanted to break it down and demystify it a bit so that you can use it inside your own Notion pages. So let's get started. We're going to go ahead and open up a Notion page that's empty so that we can show you everything with these sub-items and dependencies, and we welcome you to follow along with your own Notion workspaces as we go over this. So first, we're just going to make a database because without a database, we cannot do anything like sub-items or dependencies. And we're going to start with a table view because it's one of the most simple database views in Notion. So go ahead and type slash table. And we'll choose table view and new database. And we'll just name this sample database. And we are going to start by first adding an item here, just so that you can see how it works. So when you add a sub item to a database, what you have to do is to go to the three dots here, and then you have to toggle it on. So you click here and turn on sub items. And when you turn that on, you'll notice that when you hover, now you can see these arrows next to your item. And if you click the arrow or toggle, then you can add a new sub item. And for this, it would be sub item. And you can keep adding more sub items. And you can even add sub items. And so on. So this is a really good way to break down your main item, and particularly useful for, let's say, tasks. So if you have a main task here and then you have subtasks or a main project and what tasks lead up to that project, you can do something like that. But the one thing you should be aware of is that all of these sub items and the items share the same properties. So if this one has a tag, the sub item will also have tags. So the way it works, let's say if we add another property here, like number, and to the sub item, you'll notice that number has now appeared for everything. But what can be a little bit difficult is that let's now say that you put 5 here and 2 here, and then you go to the calculate here and you want to know the sum. It's only going to calculate the main item and not the sub item. So if you want to add those up, you actually have to do something like a roll up. And we're actually going to show you that now just so that you know that sub items need to be referred to the main item using roll up. So let's say we're going to get rid of these sub items because that makes it a little bit more confusing. So let's delete this as well. And now we just have one item with a sub item. And we can just click this item here. And we're going to add a property plus add property. And we're going to go to roll up. And you'll select the relation to be the sub item. And you can change the property of the sub item to the number, and then you can go ahead and sum that here. So now what happens is that it's gonna sum this number here. So if we add another sub item, and that sub item has a value of 3, it's gonna be reflected in this roll up here. So that's sort of a little bit more difficult to do with numbers because it looks as if it's going to add everything together at the end, but actually it's only what you see here without the sub items get summed here. And then if you wanted the inside to be summed, you have to do a roll up. So that's just good to know in case you're looking to do things with the sub item and have it reflected in the main item. So now what we wanted to show you is what sub items look like in different database views. So if we go to the three dots here and we go to layout, you can choose different database views. So now that we added the sub-item to this table view, which is very easy to understand and quite intuitive with the toggles. Let's see what it does when you put it into board view. And if you put it into board view, you'll notice that it appears on these little cards here. And if we click here, you'll see the sub-items listed over here. And you can even change the way that these are displayed. So if you wanted it as a page section, you could do it more like this, for example, or you can change it so that it looks minimal like this. So it's kind of up to you how you want to display your sub items. And they kind of show up in a way that's very similar to database relations, and it's basically treated the same way, except that you can't really only look at your sub items. The way you can see them is through the item. So now what we can do is we can also see what other database views do to sub items. So if we go to layout, we can look at it in timeline view. So when we put it in timeline view, you'll immediately notice that nothing appears, and that's because these items don't have any dates. So if we click here, you'll notice that none of these have dates. And we can just add them by clicking on them like this. And one of them has sub items, since you see that the toggle is shown in black. And if we click here, we'll see these sub items, but they're kind of not clear here because they don't have dates either. So the moment you click them, it's going to set a date. And the moment you click them, it's going to set a date. So this is what sub items look like in timeline view with these lines, which also makes it really nice to visualize how they relate to your main item. So this is quite nice as well. Now let's go back to layout and let's look at it inside a calendar. And we'll see that the sub items look pretty much the same as when it was in the card view with the board base. So it just appears under like this. And if you actually want to hide sub items appearing like this, you can also do that by clicking the three dots here and going to properties, and you could just hide sub item like this. But it's nice to see it this way, so you can keep it there, but just know that it's also possible to hide it. So now if we go to layout, we can see it in list view, and when we go to list view, it appears like this. So very simple as well, just appears underneath it. And if we go to gallery view, it's also going to do the same, that it shows under the item, and you have the option as well to hide it if you like by going to properties and then toggling the sub item off. So that's the basics of sub items in Notion. So these are just really useful if you need to add and break down tasks so that you see what the little parts are for each thing. So it's nice for broader categories, projects, and so on. So we really recommend you to try it out just to see how it could be of use to you, but just realize that is especially when we were in the table view, that the calculations, they don't necessarily reflect at the end if you want to do these kind of column calculations. So you have to do roll-ups. So next we want to talk about the dependencies in Notion. So let's go ahead and change the view from table view to timeline view, because this is the best way to visualize dependencies. You can basically add dependencies to any view because these are just views of the database. Nothing has actually changed within the data. So even if you add dependencies in table, board, calendar, list, gallery, it's all the same thing, but it's just easier to see in timeline view and probably the most useful in timeline view as well. So we're going to stick to timeline view just to show you this. And we first have to turn it on. So let's actually go to the three dots here, and we are going to go to dependencies, and we're going to turn it on. But before we turn it on, you'll see that there's various options. So the first option here says shift only when dates overlap. So these are the settings for automatic date shifting. And what this means is that if one card is overlapping another one that needs to be completed before the other one, then it's going to automatically shift the second card, as you can see in this kind of animation. So it's going to auto shift when the dates overlap between cards if you choose this option. And if you choose this one, it's going to shift and maintain the time between items. So if you slide it, it's going to put the same amount of time between each item. And this one is do not automatically shift. And here you can toggle avoid weekends or not. So if you're in a work-based environment that works 5 days a week without the weekends, then you should do this because no one's going to work on the weekends and you don't want it to end up on a weekend. So we're going to show you this on this timeline, all of these options. So let's first try shift only when dates overlap. So we turn on dependencies and we have to create some dependencies. So we're going to make a card here and we are going to put a dependency here. So this one has to be finished before this one. But let's say that we move this, it's taking longer than we expected, and it goes over here. It's automatically going to shift it over, and you'll notice that it just skipped these 2 days which were on the weekend. So if we go further like this, you'll notice that it shifted it just enough so that they don't overlap anymore. But since the weekend is over, this one shifted less. So that's how this one works. So if we go back to the dependency settings, we can now try this one, shift and maintain time between items. And if we set it there, let's see what happens. So now it should maintain the same distance when we move it. Like this. And it's still going to avoid weekends because we have that setting on. So let's say we turn off that setting, then we can see what happens. So now if we shift it, let's say it could end up on a weekend like this. So these are basically the dependency settings. And of course, the last option is to not automatically shift. So, but we recommend this shift only when dates overlap. It's just useful because it automatically shifts and you don't have to keep track of which one is going to come next. It just automatically does everything for you. And imagine if you had so many dependencies of multiple tasks, then it's just one step and everything gets shifted. So this is very, very useful. So we're going to keep these on. And that's basically the dependencies. So now let's see what happens if we put another card here and then we connect it here. Connected. It was connecting to the sub item. So now what actually happened is that this one connected to this one, which is actually a sub item of this item. So it's quite complicated now. But if we just click in here, you'll see how this works now. So this item needs to be completed before this item, and this item needs to be completed only after these two are done. So if we click here, you'll notice that there's these two things called block by and blocking. So this is what's showing the dependencies. So block by this item and it's blocking this item. So in that way, you can really see the way that tasks need to be completed and in which order. And it's very useful to see this in timeline view. So now let's see what happens when you change the view, let's say to table view, and how the dependency is shown here. So now you'll notice that we have these two columns, block by and blocking, and that's the way that these are shown. So if we click here and open, we basically see the same view we saw with the timeline view. It's just way less visual. So you kind of have an idea of what's blocking what, but you can clearly see that the strength of this dependency really lies in the timeline view. And also actually in calendar as well, you can sort of see this happening because of the auto shift. So if you shift an item that has a dependency, it's gonna auto shift as well for that. So that could be quite useful. So that's the basics for sub items and dependencies in Notion. We hope this was useful for you. If you have any questions, comments, or anything that was confusing that we talked about in this video, let us know. And we hope to see you in the next one.